Hey everybody, it's Gordon Majak here, back with another episode of Timeless Pop, Rock, and Soul. And today we are going to revisit that vibe that we explored yesterday with Jeff Lynne and ELO on their great song, Can't Get It Out of My Head, which was from 1974. Now, you may recall in that video yesterday, I was trying to explain, and I was not having much success doing so, at least in my own mind. I was trying to explain that certain vibe that is an element of that classic Jeff Lynne ELO sound. It's not the whole sound, but it's a very important element in that great Jeff Lynne ELO sound of the 70s there. And that element is, I identified it as a particular sort of Beatles influence dating back to around 1967 and some of the sounds and some of the vibes that were on those Sgt. Pepper album and the Magical Mystery Tour album. So yesterday, as we were playing that song, and of course, I love that song. I think that song, Can't Get It Out of My Head, is just an absolute masterpiece. And as I was trying to explain that particular element there, as far as the Beatles' influence on Jeff Lynne and how I thought that song really captured that certain vibe, as I was trying to explain that, I couldn't pin it down. I was just kind of being general. I couldn't pin it down exactly the way I was trying to. So today, as I was thinking about it again, I pinned it down. And really what I trace it back to specifically was a couple songs there in 1967 for the Beatles. One was All You Need Is Love, and the other one was I Am the Walrus. And part of what that vibe was that I did not do a very good job of identifying yesterday, but I did allude to it a little bit in general, was that combination of the great pop rock sounding band with that real strong classical string section. And if you think back to All You Need Is Love, and of course there's so much going on in that song, and the same for I Am the Walrus from the Beatles back there. But there's a lot going in the songs already. Yes, I understand that. But in particular, the string sections and the sound of those strings on those records was just so powerful and so unique. And so when we fast forward to Jeff Lynne and ELO carrying that Beatles influence forward into the 70s there with Can't Get It Out of My Head, once again, we hear that beautiful, powerful, classical string section combined with that really cool pop rock instrumentation. And then you throw in the vocals, and of course, John Lennon's vocals. We don't even need to talk about how great those Beatles vocals were back there in the 60s. And Jeff Lynne, again, captured that element of that vibe, too, with that sort of murky, mysterious vocal sound that is just haunting. That is the word I was looking for yesterday. It just haunts you. It sounds like it's coming from another world or from outer space or something. Love that vocal sound. And Jeff Lynne captured both of those elements of that vibe, that great Beatles vibe, which is actually... considering we're talking about All You Need Is Love and I Am the Walrus as sort of the genesis of that, we're really talking about a John Lennon vibe as expressed through the Beatles back then. So Jeff Lynne captured that, I just thought, so beautifully and magically with Can't Get It Out of My Head. So as I was thinking about it again today, I thought, well, you know, it occurred to me the ironic part of this whole thing is that John Lennon himself as a solo artist also in 1974 was sort of messing around with his own vibe that he had created back there in the 60s, and he was also carrying it forward in his own way, considering it was part of his identity and part of his sort of his musical signature in the first place. So when I realized that, I thought, why am I spending so much time trying to figure out the Jeff Lynne part of this? I should just play the John Lennon side of it, and we can just hear how beautifully these two songs, Can't Get It Out of My Head by ELO, and, well, let me show you the John Lennon. So we're going back to 1974 again, And it's funny, it's the exact same time frame of the release of the ELO song, Can't Get It Out of My Head. And for John Lennon, we are talking about, in late 1974, there, the Walls and Bridges album. And of course, the song is the classic Number 9 Dream. There's that number again. Number 9, Number 9, Number 9. John Lennon, Number 9 Dream from 1974. Now, John Lennon was having a pretty good year there in 1974. At the time that he released this song, Number 9 Dream, as the second single from Walls and Bridges there, he was coming off of a huge number one hit with Elton John called Whatever Gets You Through the Night. And so John Lennon was riding high right there in 1974, and when it came time for the next single, Number 9 Dream was the choice. And again, the ironic part is that Number 9 Dream and ELO's Can't Get Out of My Head were on the charts at the same time. So you had both the protege there in Jeff Lynne offering up sort of his vibe there, going back to the Beatles in the 60s. And then you had John Lennon himself, the creator of that particular vibe, also doing it on his solo album. And so Number 9 Dream was a big hit, not quite as big of a hit as Whatever Gets You Through the Night, which, as I said, went all the way to number one there for John and Elton John in 1974. But Number 9 Dream did get up to, wait for it, number 9 on the old pop charts. And just as is the case with the Can't Get It Out of My Head, another absolutely hauntingly beautiful, gorgeous piece of music that, as I said yesterday, who else but John Lennon could have ever invented this and brought this sound and this vibe to life. Jeff Lynne sure did one heck of a job mixing the ELO sort of signature identity with those strings, but boy, nothing like the original. From the Walls and Bridges album, this is the classic John Lennon solo Number 9 Dream. those vocals just coming from another dimension, and the way the track, the instrumental track, just as with the ELO, it's like it's riding along on this river and it's just moving, and it's so incredible. When I was thinking about this earlier today, I was thinking, you know, you almost couldn't create a track that sounds like this if you tried, but then that's such a ridiculous statement because people have tried, and it's so damn hard to do. And a few artists have captured a little of that flavor. Of course, Jeff Lynne and ELO being one. And I might throw in Tears for Fears. That's another group that sort of figured out some of the secrets of that great John Lennon, Beatles-ish, Walrus, All You Need Is Love kind of sound. But of course, on this song, John just shows them all who's truly the teacher and who's the student. But he just an amazing piece from 1974 for John. Certainly, a lot of great artists have used string sections and that classical influence in the rock music setting in any number of really cool and innovative ways. But boy, for my ears, it sure sounds to me like that flavor goes back to, again, 1967, and Eleanor Rigby had strings too, of course, and that was the year before in 1966, but you didn't have the rock and roll rhythm section on Eleanor Rigby like you did on All You Need Is Love and I Am the Walrus. So then when we fast forward to ELO and Jeff Lynne, they've got the rock and roll rhythm section there with the strings on top, as we have here in number 9. It's just intoxicating, that sound of the rock rhythm section with those beautiful string arrangements. Man, ELO right up there yesterday, and of course, John Lennon, the originator, as far as I'm concerned, of that particular incredible sound. If that isn't timeless, I don't know what is. John Lennon from 1974, Number Nine Dream. That is a song that, going back there again when I was, what, 16 in 1974? No, yeah, 16 in 1974, right. Wow, hearing that on the radio again, just like the ELO, nothing else sounded like that. I mean, those two songs, if anything, had way more in common than they did with anything else that was being played on the radio. And yeah, so that's probably where Jeff Lynne, of course, picked up the identity there of having been so heavily influenced by the Beatles. But I think Jeff proved himself, wouldn't you say? And certainly John Lennon never needed to prove any of it because he was there at the beginning. That will do it for us with this particular episode. We are getting closer. I know I keep saying it. We are getting closer. We're inching closer to the end of this little 70s run. I think we've got maybe four songs left in the 70s before we jump into some other really cool sounding music from the 2000s and the 90s, etc., etc. So that's coming up, but we still got a little bit of 70s left here. You're not going to want to miss it. Coming back with another groovy tune from the mid-70s there in the next episode. I will see you soon. Number nine, number nine, number nine, number nine, number nine.